So I'm here. My name is Olawunmi Olatunji, and I'm here with my colleague and my friend Femi Darabidan.
Hi.
Okay, so.
Alright, so basically today, thank you for having us. Basically today, we'll just be looking at two of the three most important financial statements or documents that a business person, even besides you looking for a facility, that's a loan, or you trying to get investments, or even you as an individual. Those are the three statements that you should understand. And we believe that it's a resource that the understanding of those resources will enable you to run your businesses more effectively, because it's all about the numbers. It's about the game of numbers. And those three documents are basically your income statement, your cash flow statement, and thirdly, your balance sheet.
Okay. So we have your income statement, your cash flow statement, and your balance sheet. So what I hear you say is that there are like three key areas that lenders will look at when they want to avail you some sort of facility.
Yes.
So there are some key things that they check in those books, in those statements. So I think Femi will share with us the key things that the lenders will be interested in, whether they are lenders or they are investors, the key things that they will be looking at in those statements. And also, like you said, it's more than just the interest in lending or business financing. For your own business, you also have to have
understanding.
Yes, an understanding of those key documents, your income statement, your cash flow, and your balance sheet.
So I'll just take it from the income statement. The income statement, the most difficult and yet the most critical of the lines is your sales turnover.
Okay.
Your sales turnover is a product of quantity, the right quantity, and the price, the right price. And when I say the right, I'm very careful with my words, is because if you do not sell enough and at the right price, you probably will not be able to cover for all of your expenses.
Because
if you're not selling enough volume and you're not selling at the right price, that means, let's say you are undercutting your profits in order to sell more or to attract more customers, you probably not still have enough money to take care of your overheads or your expenses. So it doesn't still make sense as a business person and as your investor or as your banker trying to give you money. He has to be able to convince, he has to be convinced that you have that commercial quantity or commercial value for the business you are pitching for you to get more funding. Do you understand? So basically, the sales turnover is very critical, is very fundamental, and get it right. And in looking at your sales, in determining or forecasting your sales, you also have to understand that you must have done some detailed market research or groundwork before you go to the field to push out products for sale. That means you must have checked the market size, you must have checked competition, is your product viable, does your product have, you know, substitutes that can easily take you off the market, they want to result in you not selling enough. So you have to look at all of those things at the background, but most importantly, your income statement is your sales turnover figure.
So, I think this also applies to whether you are in the service industry or sales turnover, but if you are also in the service industry,
or products, sales or products,
whatever you are doing,
it applies to both.
Okay.
So, if you are providing services, your services should also, you know, have that kind of volume that is substantial enough to cover your running expenses, which you call the operating expenses, or even the cost of buying those products or services that you are selling. You know, basically. So if we have been able to get the sales turnover right, which every banker wants to see, because when you say you're a business person, the next question I want to ask you is, what are you selling?
Exactly.
What are you selling?
Exactly.
So if you can explain to me what you are selling, and I ask you at what price, then I can have an idea whether you are actually selling at a commercial value or quantity or not. Do you understand? So now that takes us to us netting off your expenses. And the first point of call is your cost of goods sold. That is the cost of acquiring either the raw material or the finished product or the services that you are selling.
Okay.
If you are able to ascertain how much it costs you to put that service in the market,
okay,
or to buy that product as a raw material and to put it on the market, that is your cost of goods sold. That's the cost of the item you are selling. And this could also come with some direct costs, like the labor you expended or the transportation you expended in bringing that product to the market or in creating that product.
So far we are back to key items. Yes. The cost of goods sold.
The cost of goods sold is very important. You understand the cost of goods sold. Right. So that takes you to your gross profit.
Okay.
So when you get your gross profit, the reason why it is gross profit is because there are still some items that we need to take out.
Yes.
You know, you hear the word gross.
Yeah,
it means it is not net. Mm-hmm. It is gross. Mm-hmm. That it still contains some elements that we need to extract in order to come to what we call the net income.
Okay, so the net income.
Yes. So now, when you get your gross profit and you are able to ascertain what your operational expenses are.
Okay.
Your operational expenses are usually your rent,
yeah,
that's the rent, your office rent, salaries, utilities like electricity, water,
telecoms,
internet services, you know, subscriptions,
yeah,
that you run month on month,
yeah,
just to keep the office,
yeah,
running.
Yeah.
When you're able to ascertain each of those cost lines, that you must determine them individually.
Okay.
Do you understand? And you back them out, that means you subtract them from your gross profit that you've earlier determined. Okay, now that takes you to your operational profit. Now, operational profit is very, very key.
Okay.
Because your operational profit can also be identified or be termed as your earnings before interest
and tax,
and taxes,
yeah,
and depreciation, which is EBITDA. We call it EBITDA, EBITDA.
Yeah.
That is your earnings before interest, taxes, and depreciation. So if you're able to ascertain your operational profit, and this is where your banker friend is very, very interested. Yes, because like we said, it is called earnings before interest. The interest is what you pay to the bank on every loan that you take from them. So what's your EBITDA or your operational profit just for that is trying to advance you in facility is to determine if you have the capacity,
okay,
to pay back the loan if you take the loan from them. So without you having a positive operational profit for the banker to look at, that means you probably do not have the capacity in the first place to even come seek for
it. So you mean now that's one key thing bankers will look at in your income statement. Whether you have a positive operational profit.
So your positive because as a law-abiding citizen who runs a business in Nigeria, it's expected that you are a taxpayer and that you remit your taxes. But your taxes cannot be taken on a new. So it's something you make imagine that you are actually, you know, under obligation
to pay,
your tax, your company income tax to the government. So your internal revenue, they are very interested also in your profit. So when you are not making enough profit in your business, as determined by your personal profit, then you can always find your new returns. You can always find your new returns so that you know that you are actually not making profits at the moment. Yes, but it is expected for you to understand that your operational profit is very, very vital. And for the banker, I know that for commercial banks and even for microfinance banks, you cannot be advanced a loan that is more than 33.3% of your earnings, and that earnings is your EBITDA, is your operational profit. That means whatever loan you are taking, it is a multiple of your operational profit.
I think that is also what happens when you don't take for personal finance.
Yes,
you see, personal finance. Of your salary.
Of your salary.
It's still the same concept that goes in.
And even that salary, when it comes to personal finance, it's not the totality of the salary. It also comes back to the net.
Net, yes, definitely.
Because as a personal finance credit analyst, when you look at people's statements of account, you want to discount some statutory deductions. You want to deduct, you know, maybe other obligations that you have before you arrive at a next figure that you believe this is the exact take-home pay
for that person.
Then it is based on that you determine what the loan amount will be. Same thing goes for business. So by the time you discount all of the operational expenses, the cost of bringing the goods to the market or purchasing the goods we are selling, it also brings us to that position where we cannot use your operational profit. To advance your goal. That would be a determining factor for advancing your goal. So basically, operational profit is very, very vital, and you should take it very, very seriously. So when you let your interest, let's say you eventually take a loan, and also the taxes that is due to the federal government, income tax, and also less your depreciation, you should make provisions for depreciation. By the time we take out all of those three items, it brings us to what we call the earnings before, sorry, brings us to profit after tax, which is your next income. And your net income is very important. So your investors, you know, I've not spoken about investors all this while. Now, the investors are very keen in knowing how much naira you are having to generate for every unit of item sold or every unit of service provided from the sales figure.
So like the return.
Yes, they are very keen about your net income. That is after all deductions, including your taxes, depreciation, including your interest on loans taken, including all your operational expenses, and also your cost of goods sold. Everything backed out, your investors are very interested at that point. Okay, having settled all obligations, what is left? That means you need a substantial amount of sales at the very top to justify what is at the bottom. So if you are able to give them then it makes an investment viable and attractive. Yes, a good return on every cover that you sell for them. So that's just the basic thing about the income statement. And let's also understand that the income statement, which is your profit and loss account,
yes,
it's a good statement, but one of its shortcomings is that you may not really ascertain the health of your business, so to speak, because it includes both credit sales and also cash sales. So when you see sales turnover, it does not always represent that you have received the money. But the fact that some people have come to purchase from you, whether it's on credit or on cash basis, we account for it as a sale or a sold item.
Yeah.
Do you understand? So now, this now takes us to the next.
So, talking about the cash flow. Yeah. It's very key for us to know the difference between, yes, I have income, I'm making money, but how liquid am I?
Exactly.
Cash is like king, that is,
cash is king.
Lifeblood of your business. So, we're going to the cash flow now and see how important that is in your business.
Yeah. So, without you arriving at a net income from your income statement, you can't move on to the cash flow. You know, we are talking about startups, we are talking about small business owners that most times have to do projected, like forecast for your businesses. Now, we need to forecast like a profit and loss account or an income statement to the point of, this business promises a net income at the end of the day, a positive net income at the end of the day. Now, how much of this net income is actually cash? That's what we're trying to determine using a cash flow statement. Yes, and in fact, it seems that how much cash is needed should be put into the business, and how much cash the business will throw off each year to generate a return on that investment. That's what we're trying to determine. How much cash really is in the business? Because, like she said, and it's a general concept that cash is king.
Yeah.
In fact, a business can have a very solid balance sheet, but if it has a bad income statement and cash flow statement, it's just a matter of time.
Yes.
It's like sucking blood out of the fish. Wow. You shut down the fish. Do you understand? So, we're saying the same thing. Cash flow is very important, and then investors, your bankers, your shareholders, even your staff that are working for you, because without a good cash flow, you can't pay your salaries.
You can't pay salaries.
You can't pay salaries if your cash flow is not healthy. You can't pay your contractors or suppliers if your cash flow is not healthy. So regardless of whether you have given us a fantastic sales figure of selling 50 million sales in a year, your banker is not after your sales figure. What is actually after is, if I give you this money as a loan, do you have the capacity to meet your monthly or yearly or quarterly repayments as I went to you? And this is a function of how much liquidity that you have. It's a function of your liquidity and it's a function of the cash that you have. So this takes us to this next point, that your profit after tax, which is your net income, has to be critically examined. Now, how do you do this? Because you need to know how to do this to come to your net cash figures. Do you understand? Now, after you have been able to project a net income, now what we're saying is, take your inventory figure, that means whatever you have purchased within the period that you are accounting for, let's say 12 months or 6 months, take that change in inventory, that means your stock now. Maybe you have purchased some things. Now, you take it out of your net income as a backtrack of your net income. You need to declare your net income as what is remaining after you have deducted all expenses. But don't forget that during the course of the year, your inventory level rose. Now, the cash you used in buying that inventory that rose has left your business.
Yes.
But you don't account for it in your profit and loss account or your income statement. You've not done that. So what I'm saying in essence is that you have to recognize it.
That fact.
Yes, that money left you to buy supplies. Money left you to stock up. Money left you to buy goods into that supermarket. That same money that you have not accounted for, you know there is no purchases in your net income. And in your income statement, you didn't account for your purchases. Now you're going to go back and you're going to deduct the change, that's the difference, in your inventory. So if your inventory level has changed by, let's say, 1 million naira, go to your next income and back out that 1 million naira because you have actually made purchases and cash left you. Yes, cash left you. So take it out of that position. Also, your account receivable.
Yeah.
That means you have supplied goods. People have not paid you. Remember in your income statement, you accounted for all your sales without distribution, whether it is credit or cash. Now we have come to the cash flow statement that we are saying that receivable that you are expecting from goods you supplied, whatever money that you are expecting, is not yet in your hands. So you cannot account for it as part of the cash in your pocket or your bank account. So you have to also take it out. Take it out of the figure you are seeing as the net profit. You need to back it up. And also, now app.
Okay.
This is all I said now. The first one we said, take out your inventory, your change in inventory. You said, take out account receivable. Now, the third one, which you have to add back. You have to add back account payable. Why are you adding back account payable? It's simple. The logic is this. Money that you are owing somebody is payable. And you have not paid it.
So it's not yours.
It's not yours. But you are still going to it. So it is still cash, either in your safe, in your office, in your shop, or at the bank. So we have to recognize it that it's part of the cash you are still holding. But it's not your own, but you are still holding it. Don't forget that what we are doing under the cash flow statement is the analysis of your cash. And you need to understand that there are some monies that are not your own, that are still with you. You are not paid. Maybe you are even owing rent, but the money is still with you. But you cannot recognize it that you are paid rent when you are not paid it. So you need to hand it back to the money in your hands. So when we have gotten that, then it will now bring us to the point of saying, okay, the cash flow from the operations brings us to a comfortable position that we can say, oh, this is the cash flow from the operations of this business. Because we have taken out your account receivables, we have taken out your inventory,
and
we have added back your payables that you have not paid. The money has not gone out of you. So now this gives us a comfortable position to look at and say, okay, during the course of the year also, you probably bought a motor vehicle for your business. And you probably purchased office equipment, maybe computers,
laptop,
generator, you know, and office accessories or something, which are capital expenditure. But you have not recognized it yet. Though you might have added it to your balance sheet as part of your assets, but you have not taken care of it in your cash analysis. Now, you have to come to your cash flow statement and also recognize that capital expenditure. You need to back it out. So when you back it out, you will now have your true position. You have taken out your inventory, you have taken out your account receivable that you have not received, we have added back your account payable as you have not paid to the people you are owing. Now we have taken out your capital expenditures. It's all coming from the cash with you. Do you understand? So now this brings us to a position that we can now look at your cash flow and say, does this business have a healthy cash flow or not?
And the same applies to even if you are in the service industry, you might not have inventory.
Yes.
Take out in that sense, but every other thing.
Every other thing applies to you. Yeah, applies to you. Same principle. Applies
to you. Payable and then
expenditure. So now, the position you now get to, after you have done all these four items, you have taken care of all these four items, is your pre-financing cash flow. Now, we will now know whether you truly need more cash or not. You know, when people walk into the bank and they come to meet you as an account officer and they ask you, I need an overdraft.
Mm-hmm.
You ask for what purpose, they say for working capital. This is actually how you know whether you are qualified for working capital or not. If you look at your books and you have not judiciously managed your cash flow very well, it is not all the time that you get a yes for a loan request. At times, the money is with you, you have not just recognized certain aspects of it for you to help you to understand your true position. And you might not even need as much as the money you're asking for.
Exactly.
It's because you have not done this analysis.
Exactly.
So when your banker comes in there and says no, you can't advance your money. You need to go back to your books and look at what we are talking about right now. Your cash flow. So when we see that there is a deficit, maybe now your business has supplied goods and you have done all these analysis and you have salaries to pay, you have electricity bills to pay, you have some running expenses to take care of, and you still do not have enough cash to cover.
Okay.
That is when working capital, that the working capital loan or an overdraft facility can kick in to support you pending when the money you are expecting comes in or the cash you are expecting comes in. It is not at every instance.
So is that just a bridge?
It's a bridge.
Exactly.
It's a short-term financing just for you to turn the cycle. Some people, the business cycle is 90 days, some people it's 120 days, depending on the nature of the business, you run.
And in fact, if they leave you an overdraft and you don't have an effective cash flow, that would rather become poor. That means it becomes like a terminal because you are not servicing your assets, you are not bringing it back at the way the bank structure is. So it goes to say if you don't even have any book of accounts, there's no way you can even
track this. So you can track it. The most important thing is to document all your transactions. If you don't document all your transactions, and when I say documentation, it also extends to you keeping a separate bank statement for your transactions, for the business. Make an effort. Take that deposit, that cash payment that was brought to your office, take it to the bank. Make an effort. Use a POS machine for your collections. Make an effort. Tell people to deposit directly into the bank account.
Between a separate line of.
Do you understand? So that we can monitor the cash flow better and be able to advise whether you need a loan, an overdraft, or not, or whether you need a working capital support or not. And, that just wraps it up. Right? I think maybe subsequent decisions, we can talk about balance sheet.
Exactly.
But always remember, cash is king.
Cash is
but before cash can be king, you must be profitable. Mm-hmm. Is your business profitable? Are you selling enough? Are you selling at the right price? And I think that's just
quite simple. Thank you very much. You did a wonderful side, Femi.